Oh, this is Marla Dalton, Executive Director and CEO of the National Foundation for Infectious Diseases, or NFID. As COVID-19 vaccination efforts continue across the U.S., some questions and concerns about potential side effects are also circulating. In addition to the typical sore arm and fatigue, reports have recently surfaced about individuals suffering from various symptoms after getting vaccinated. But just because one event follows another in time does not necessarily mean it was caused by the event itself. With me today is NFID Medical Director, Dr. William Schaffner, to help explain the difference between causation and coincidence, and to help us distinguish between COVID-19 vaccine facts and fiction. So Bill, what are some of the most common side effects of COVID vaccines, and what should people realistically expect after getting vaccinated?
Well, Marla, as we all know, when we get inoculated with any vaccine, we expect a sore arm. And certainly that's part of what we've learned about the COVID vaccines. They are reactogenic. That is, they will make many people's arms sore for a day or two. Some people actually also get a rash on that arm near the injection site. You can feel tired for a day, not have really a lot of energy, and even some muscular aches and pains. My associate here, when she got the vaccine, developed chilly sensations for the first day, and a few people get a degree or two of fever for a day or two. Now, these things will go away after 24 or 48 hours. We can deal with those readily. Some people will take a little acetaminophen in order to help them get over it if they feel uncomfortable. And they're easily something that I think we can tolerate in order to avoid getting COVID itself, which of course can put you in the hospital and even the intensive care unit. So as the high school coaches used to tell us, no gain, no pain. And so you have to pay a small, I think, physical price, many of us, when we get our COVID vaccines, but it's easily worth it.
Absolutely. So building on that, what do you make of the recent reports about possible vaccine side effects, such as hearing loss or myocarditis?
Now we're into something a bit more complicated. We all know the association between getting an injection and a sore arm, but what about some of these other ailments that people have had following the vaccine? So if you get the vaccine on Monday, just let's say, and on Thursday, you develop some chest pain, apropos of the myocarditis, inflammation of the heart, or some ringing in your ears, tinnitus or hearing loss, are the two related? We have to remember, first off, that even if there were no COVID vaccines, these sorts of events occur on a regular basis in the population, particularly as we've been, at least early on, vaccinating preferentially older people. Stuff happens to older people. And so we have to try to distinguish, is there a relationship? Or is this just a coincidence? It would have happened in any event. What most people don't recognize, or don't realize, I perhaps should say, is that the United States has the world's most comprehensive vaccine safety surveillance system. We have a system in place that is constantly looking for potential adverse events that follow any vaccine that we use in infancy, childhood, or adulthood. And this system has been ginned up after COVID. So all those reports come in and then they're carefully evaluated. Now, you mentioned two illnesses, one very much in the news at the present time, which is this inflammation of the heart muscle, myocarditis, particularly occurring in young adults, older teenagers and young adults, 16 to 39 years of age, mostly males, and after the second dose of one of those mRNA vaccines, either the Pfizer vaccine or the Moderna vaccine. The signal that went up, that was then carefully analyzed by the CDC, now seems to indicate that this myocarditis, this inflammation of the heart, does indeed occur more frequently after vaccination than it would under normal conventional circumstances. Now, fortunately, there haven't been any deaths. This is a transient problem, and people seem to get better fairly quickly with standard therapy. So that's all to the good. It occurs pretty uncommonly, one of these cases for every 50,000 doses of the vaccine that are administered. And it usually presents with chest pain and perhaps some shortness of breath. And all doctors are now very much on the alert looking for this. And so if you have one of those complaints, please call your healthcare provider. Now, in contrast to the myocarditis, which does appear to be causally related to these vaccines, the question of hearing loss or noises in the ear, tinnitus, has not yet sent up a signal, which means that as far as we can tell at the present time, it does not appear that that's causally related to the vaccine. Remember, just because B follows A doesn't mean that the two are causally related. Here's a facetious little example. We all know that the rooster crows before the dawn, but we don't think the rooster makes the sun come up. So that's a coincidence, not a causal relationship. And hearing loss and that buzzing in the ear, tinnitus, appear at the moment, analyses are ongoing, but at the moment, not to be causally related to the vaccine, fortunately.
So, Bill, can you tell us a little bit more about how public health experts actually distinguish between potential vaccine side effects and a completely unrelated coincidence?
Yeah, well, first of all, you have to get all the information about possible side effects, and that's the surveillance system. Any healthcare provider or any individual, if they've been vaccinated and then subsequently had an ailment, an illness, symptoms of any kind that they think might be related, can report this to a system called the Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System. VAERS, V-A-E-R-S. You can Google it. It'll lead you very quickly to a simple report form. You fill it out and send it in. There's the report. We gather all these reports and then assess how frequently they may occur in comparison to this illness, these symptoms occurring in a population that's completely unvaccinated, but of comparable age and sex distribution, for example. That's what we call the background rate of the illness. And if there's a signal, that is, it looks as though this symptom complex, this illness, whatever you're concerned about, myocarditis, for example, is occurring more frequently among the vaccinated than among the unvaccinated, then further analyses are done to try to determine whether that relationship is causal. And it looks as though, for example, that myocarditis is causal. But you, as lay people, if we have a single example, if it happens to me, I get my vaccine on Monday and then I get symptoms on Thursday, I say to myself, gee, nothing else happened to me that was unusual except the vaccine. Golly, it must be the vaccine. Or perhaps if I'm a little more careful, I'll say it might have been the vaccine. But that's why we report all these things. You can't draw conclusions on the basis of a single case, but you can if you gather all this information together and compare the frequency of the occurrence of these symptoms among vaccinated people versus a population that's unvaccinated. And that allows the scientists to draw the conclusions about whether it's causal or just coincidental.
Very, very helpful. So Bill, what do you say to people who are concerned about possible long-term side effects of the COVID vaccines?
Long-term. You know, that's one of the most frequently asked questions that I find recently. And by long-term, people mean not just in these days or weeks after vaccination, but 2 years, 5 years, 10 years later. I'm smiling a little bit because vaccine experts scratch their heads about that because that's kind of a new idea to them. Why is that? Well, because of all the vaccines that we give in infancy and childhood and indeed in adulthood, none of them have quote unquote long-term effects that show up 2 years, 5 years, or 10 years later. That just doesn't exist. There's no biological mechanism for that. And I understand the average person's interest in that. But there, I think we can be very, very reassuring. There's simply no precedent in any vaccine that we've ever used, now given in the millions upon millions of doses, of any genuinely long-term effects. And there's no biological reason for any to occur.
So Bill, to wrap this up really, I guess it all comes down to how do we weigh the risks of vaccination against the benefits?
Well, experts have a very formal process and we as individuals have a more individual process. You know, there's a committee that assesses, is there a public health problem? How good is this vaccine? Is it effective? What indeed are the demonstrated side effects? What's, in other words, the safety of the vaccine? How feasible is it to implement a vaccination program? Will it be acceptable to the population vaccinated and indeed to the healthcare providers? That process is called evidence to recommendations, and it's very rigorous. And it's done by an external advisory committee to the CDC. That advisory committee is called the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices. And it has been doing things like this for all vaccines that we use, if you can imagine, for over 70 years. So obviously, this is an experienced, well-regarded process. So that's where the recommendations come from the CDC. Now, those are the experts. So how does the average person do that? In a much less formal fashion, they talk to their friends, they talk to their healthcare providers, they do listen to the TV, many go on social media. That's something I'm a little wary of because there's a lot of good information and a lot of junk, frankly, on misinformation on social media, and they become comfortable and reassured. They get information that goes to their brain, but then they want to feel comfortable in making that decision. That's kind of a heart decision. How do you feel about it? And as a combination of all those things, people make their decision about getting vaccinated for themselves and for their family members. Bottom line, I always say, speak with that healthcare provider in whom you have trust. Trust is so important. Get good information from people whom you trust.
Absolutely. Bill, thanks again for your invaluable insights. Before we close, I guess I'll ask if there are any other comments you'd like to offer in general.
Just in general, as we all know, we've made so much progress with our vaccination program. The proportion of our now adult population vaccinated is creeping up toward 70%. And I say creeping up because obviously there are still many hesitant people And they're really quite hesitant because they haven't been vaccinated. So I would just urge them to consider very seriously getting vaccinated. You know, there are variant strains of the virus out there. A new one called the Delta strain is now wreaking some havoc in Europe. It originally came from India. It's here in the United States, hasn't quite taken off yet, but it's very contagious and tends to make more severe disease when it infects you. Fortunately, our current vaccines do work against this Delta strain. So all the more reason for as many people as possible to get vaccinated in order to protect ourselves and also to make our communities as safe as possible.
Well said, as always. Bill, thanks again. We'll look forward to continuing the discussions on a future episode of the Schaffner Report. Have a great day.